Good morning, good afternoon, good evening to all participants on the third day of the this year IDM. Before we start, I just would like to remind all that after the panelists of each panel, you'll have possibility to use the Q&A function to raise the question or ask for the floor, as well as a raise of the hand function. Before we start with the first panel today, we will watch one small video one more time to underline the importance of the migrant stories, something that always IDM has, but this time, due to the virtual event that we are organizing, we'll actually show the movie. Under the campaign done by IOM IDM, what is Do Together, IOM.ent, where you can see a little bit more on those stories. This story is called Mila's story. That basically, we learn a little bit more on the Martian Iceland's problem on somebody who is on the front line and somebody who's actually feel what climate change can do to the migrant. Please go ahead with video.
My name is Mila Noah. I'm 13 years old and I live on Ligeb Atoll in the Marshall Islands. My dream is to become a professional wrestler. I love my home so much because it is so beautiful. Everything in this place is good. I did not know what climate change meant. Then one day, some people came to our island on a yacht. They told me the seas are rising and one day, Ligeb might disappear under the water. That scared me and made me sad. At my family's house, we have a seawall to help protect us if the water rises. But I don't know if it will be strong enough. There is a marker in the sea at one end of Ligeb. When the tide is out, you can see where the edge of the land used to be. Now, it is underwater most of the time because the sea has eaten the shore away. Sometimes the seawater washes into the wells and makes the water salty, so we can't drink it. At our school, we have a machine that takes the salt out of the water, but we still have to be very careful how much water we use. Our teachers say the weather is hotter than when they were young. That is why we have so much drought now, and it is much more difficult to grow fruit and vegetables. Me and the other children in Ligeb love to play together, climbing trees and swimming in the lagoon. And we love the animals that live here. Some of my friends help raise turtles. They keep the babies safe from being washed away by the sea or killed by other animals till they are big enough to go back in the lagoon. Next year, I will have to leave Ligeb to finish high school on the Big Island. Even though I love it here, I may have to stay away for a while if I want to do more studies and learn wrestling. But this is my home, and I want to be able to come back one day. If it disappears under the sea, I don't know where I will go. When I think about climate change, I know we all have to be strong and stand together. So the land is not destroyed, and animals and people can always have somewhere to come home to. Thank you.
Now I would like to give the floor to today moderator, who is Mrs. Dina Ionesco, who is basically someone who is behind most of the work that we did in this year, IDM, head of the Migration, Environment and Climate Change Unit within the IOM. Dina, floor is yours.
Yes, hello. Thank you so much, Dan, and thank you for kind words, and thank you for amazing collaboration to put this event together today. I'm very happy that we started with this video because our panel today will speak of different stakeholders' approaches, and I think that kids are at the center of who the main stakeholders of all this discussion are today. And also the video we just saw, it's very important for us because it's part of the work we do with our fund, with IDF fund, that it's a key support to our work on capacity development and not only communication and beautiful image that say migrants' voices, but beyond it, really supporting our work. So I will do a short introduction for the panel, and I will explain how the panel goes on and who our wonderful speakers are today. I want to greet absolutely everyone who is already online with us. As a first remark, I just wanted to take you 2 minutes back in the past. 70 years ago, IOM was born. It's a daughter of the Second World War and grew its first years in the Cold War. It's in 1990, so it took us 40 years to start looking into environment and climate change. And the trigger was the 1990 IPCC, so the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, first report that was really already sending signals that migration and climate change can be connected, and we should care about that. And it's since then that IOM kicked off its action on this topic. 20 years ago, we are in 2001, the organization launched this international dialogue on migration. It's the oldest dialogue at multilateral level that exists. And 2001, the world was shocked by the fall of the Twin Towers. So here we are, again, 20 years after. 10 years ago, 2011, we organized an international dialogue on migration, environment, and climate change, and 10 years more have passed. We are in 2021. We are also shocked by this pandemic that has taken the world over and had such an impact on migration, and we are here on Zoom, all of us, because of that. But in spite of Zoom, being all Zoomed, we want energy for this panel. We want two key things. And before I give the floor to the panelists, we want to highlight two key messages just for today as we start the last day of our dialogue and we start this session. First thing that we want to say is that we look very often at climate change and migration, at the tragic and displacement and sad dimension of it. But we want also to make sure that we look at the positive outcomes of migration, at the adaptive dimension of migration, and at the contribution of migrants, of diasporas, to climate action and to sustainable development. This is one of the key objectives of our panel today, to showcase solutions, to showcase voices and examples of what can be done. And the second key message, we are at the heart of what an international multilateral dialogue is about. It's about different voices, bringing extremely different perspectives, and that's what our panel will do today. So for the panel today, I will introduce our speakers as we go ahead, but we have the chance to have a keynote speaker today, and the chance, the immense chance, to have the Minister of Environment and Physical Planning of North Macedonia, Mr. Naser Nuredini. We are extremely pleased to have you on because I think I understand you also have a migrant experience quite strong in your own life, but also because we saw that Your Excellencies, you have key goals to drive really clean and green investments in the home region, and also to use your migration and cross-border experience to bridge the differences between West and East and bring everyone together. And I also understood that you have a very strong passion from green economics. And this is at the heart of our discussion today. How do we connect this discussion on migration and displacement to green growth and what solution we can see? So we look forward to having your presentation today about the strong political engagement and the commitments from North Macedonia as much at the regional, global and national levels. So we look forward to this. I pass on to, floor to you and give us energy.
Thank you, Ms. Ionescu, dear participants, dear friends, dear colleagues. First of all, thank you for actually giving us the opportunity as the Republic of North Macedonia to participate in this very interesting, so to speak, topic. And as the video so clearly stated, we're all in it together. It's not an individual issue we're facing here. To start off with, I think after watching that video, one can only be emotional about it and realize that we don't only need to do our part for our country and our region, we need to do our part for the whole world in this instance. As we all know, and you mentioned, we've been Zooming ourselves lately because of the COVID-19 pandemic, which has been a very unfortunate event, and we've all been caught off guard in this event. However, though, thankfully, we have the smartest people in the world working together for the first time to find a solution. And they have. We've got vaccinations, we've got the rolling out, which will support, hopefully, us to overcome this. Climate change is something that has always impacted the livelihood of the citizens. We've known about this over the last few decades, I would say. So the COVID-19 might have caught us off guard, but climate change is not catching us off guard. However, though, if we do not act now, we should have acted already. But if we do not act now, we're going to further have issues of actually endangering the livelihoods of our citizens. We are a small country in the southern southeast of Europe, in the Western Balkans. We are a country which is developing, is going to be working towards the EU accession. However, though, we're also very well aware that we are a country which is going to be impacted heavily by climate change. We already have, and as Mr. Ionescu mentioned, I am a child who's been growing up abroad, coming back, etc. These were our challenges in the past, were more economic challenges, hence why we have a lot of immigration from our country to other countries. As a country in itself, though, we are in the path, of course, for international migration. So let's to just state one thing. A few years ago, we had over 1 million migrants passing through our country towards the developed countries of the EU. Now, in order to actually try and participate and contribute to the global issue, we as a country, of course, we revised our NDC to the Paris Agreement. We have taken a very bold decision to lower greenhouse gases by 51% compared to the 1990 levels by 2030. Which is a net reduction of 82%. Now, this sounds bold and this sounds costly. However, though, one of the things that we all need to be aware of is the investments in green energy, in renewable energy, sustainable development are actually a change of our own behavior. It means the changing of our consumer, the way we consume the products, what we consume. So these are actually costs. This will be actually a benefit and a profit, as we like to say. The investments we're making today will be a profit to our citizens, not only our citizens locally, but if everyone does their part, it will be a benefit to everybody in the world. As we know, what we do actually, of course, is in order to create, so to speak, the post-COVID-19 economic recovery, which will create a sustainable development and an inclusion as well of the socially vulnerable groups, not only in our country, but also the migrants who move to our country. And hopefully maybe potentially entice our own citizens to move back to us, is we're looking to create the green economic recovery. However, the green economic recovery sounds a bit mythic. However, if we look into the details, what we're saying is we want to invest in renewable energy. We want to invest in energy efficiency. So we have set up these funds. These are labor-intensive jobs. These are local products. This is going to support the local economy to restart. But it's not only about the economy. At the same time, we are going to be using less energy. A country like ours, which is unfortunately very heavily dependent on coal producing electricity through a coal-fired power plant, we need to move away from that. Hence, while we are committed to decarbonization, we are actually going to go green. We're going to invest in solar, wind, and hydro. What does this mean is the fact that this will be creating new jobs for our own citizens here, as well as migrants that might move to us. This, unfortunately, if we want to stop this, because we will have more migration in the world the whole time if the climate is changing. Living conditions, especially for the, especially for islands, which are very susceptible to climate change, are going to become more and more difficult. I think it is our obligation, every single one of us globally, to participate, minimize the effects, support the migrants who are actually losing their livelihoods due to climate change, due to the economic developments of the developed countries. Thereby, I've also said this in other conferences to the international colleagues of ours. It is not just us, the small countries, that needs to make these very ambitious dedication to climate change. There's also an obligation to the large developed countries to support the smaller developing countries and also large developing countries in order to for them to actually become more sustainable. We all know that the developing countries have been developing over the last decades and decades. They've achieved a certain life standard, and we should support the other developing countries now to achieve that, that same life standard through sustainable development. And because I also understand that there was also arguments from developing countries, if they have polluted in the past to achieve that standard, then we should be allowed as well. Hence why I think it's an obligation of all of us to support these areas, these countries, to develop in a sustainable way so that we can all make a change and minimize the effects of climate change. Thank you very much for the opportunity. I look forward to hearing from the other panelists.
Thank you so much, Excellency, for this very realistic and encouraging speech. I would say that to have a minister speaking in the same speech about emotions and ambitions and the nationally determined contributions, it's a wonderful mix of how much we need both vision and heart and really concrete, very concrete commitments for this topic. Thank you also for highlighting the points on that countries now are, the majority of countries are home, destination, and transit countries, and the challenges for small and medium and big, big countries all together joining in the same objectives, in fact. So thank you so much for bringing this vision into our panel today. As a next step, I will just very briefly mention the names of our speakers on the panel. We have five speakers, and then each time I will introduce more specifically each panelist. So we have Dr. Amadou Diaw from Senegal, who is a technical advisor at the Ministry for Foreign Affairs and of Senegalese Abroad. We have Dr. Balgis Osman-Elasha from the African Development Bank, where she's a chief climate change and green growth specialist. We have Ms. Enja, Saethren, who is a senior business specialist at Scatec in Norway. We do have also Mr. Irfan, Ullah, Afridi, who is representing our youth and also advocacy voice with the United Nations Major Group for Children and Youth. And we have Mr. Belal Altineso, who represents the voice of, let's say, also civil society, migrants, and also as an entrepreneur in the private sector, co-founder of the So Ranch. So maintenant, je vais juste passer à la parole à notre prochain intervenant qui, je crois, parle en français. Donc, nous avons Dr. Amadou Diaw, qui représente pour nous dans ce panel où on a essayé d'avoir des voix extrêmement différentes et complémentaires dans la discussion. Monsieur Amadou Diaw, qui est conseiller technique au cabinet du secrétaire d'État chargé des Sénégalais de l'extérieur au ministère des Affaires étrangères et des Sénégalais à l'extérieur du Sénégal. Vous êtes là-bas en charge vraiment aussi des questions migration, changement climatique, dégradation des terres et environnement, donc parfaitement dans notre thème d'aujourd'hui. Il est très important pour nous d'avoir la vision du côté gouvernemental dans cette discussion pour mieux comprendre aussi le rôle et comment nous lions cela aux questions des contributions des diasporas et des migrants à la lutte contre le changement climatique. Vous avez une très longue expérience en sociologie, en démographie. Vous avez travaillé dans de nombreux cabinets aussi internationaux. Donc, et vous travaillez aussi à l'accompagnement et l'insertion des réfugiés et des demandeurs d'asile dans le passé. Donc, c'est un merveilleux parcours. Monsieur Diaw, je vous passe la parole. Merci beaucoup.
Merci beaucoup. Tout d'abord, bonjour à tout le monde. Je dois tout d'abord remercier l'ensemble des organisateurs d'avoir bien voulu associer activement le gouvernement du Sénégal à cette première session du dialogue international sur la migration 2021 et remercier très particulièrement toutes les équipes de l'OIM, que ce soit au niveau siège, niveau bureau régional ou niveau bureau pays, pour leur mobilisation et leur disponibilité sans faille à toujours accompagner les initiatives du gouvernement du Sénégal, mais surtout toujours à œuvrer pour que le Sénégal puisse être associé à un certain nombre de dynamiques qui sont en cours. Il est important, justement, dans ce cadre, dans un premier temps, de rappeler que le gouvernement du Sénégal, l'État du Sénégal, participe à plusieurs approches multipartites qui vise une meilleure intégration des migrants et de leur implication dans les questions relatives au nexus migration, environnement et changement climatique. Le Sénégal participe à presque beaucoup de projets qui sont autour de ces questions-là, notamment avec la plateforme Midwap pour ce qui concerne l'Afrique de l'Ouest, la plateforme PDD sur tout ce qui concerne les risques de désastres, le projet un peu MM3 qui vise à inclure la question de la migration dans la planification locale au niveau des collectivités territoriales pour montrer la nécessité justement d'agir à des échelles extrêmement divergentes pour avoir une complémentarité, une synergie des actions pour que les actions vont véritablement aux migrants. Et ça, cette approche inclusive et intégrée, elle est extrêmement importante à promouvoir dans tout ce que nous faisons. Et aujourd'hui, il faut aussi reprendre un peu le contexte du Sénégal. Le Sénégal est un État côtier qui dispose aujourd'hui de 718 km de côte. Et surtout avec un certain nombre d'îles, comme l'île de Gorée par exemple, la ville de Saint-Louis qui est presque une presqu'île, qui est une agglomération. Vous prenez la capitale sénégalaise, Dakar, c'est presque une presqu'île. Donc, soumis à des risques à la fois de submersion marine et des régions côtières, ce sont des questions où je suis très à l'aise pour en parler parce que justement, ma thèse de doctorat a porté sur l'adaptation des communautés côtières sur le changement climatique. Certes, je l'ai fait dans un contexte totalement différent parce que c'était le long de la Manche, sur la façade française et la façade anglaise. C'est parce que j'ai fait ma thèse de doctorat à l'Université de Caen. Mais depuis, avant même de finir ma thèse, j'ai commencé à travailler sur plusieurs projets au Sénégal en tant que consultant international sur la gestion des risques côtiers. Donc, ce sont des problématiques que j'ai vécues de l'extérieur. Et par ailleurs, je suis originaire de la ville de Saint-Louis, où l'on sait la langue de barbarie a été bouffée par une partie totalement, entièrement par la mer. Et qu'aujourd'hui, nous sommes là-bas avec un projet qui est financé par ailleurs par la Banque mondiale et l'AFD à un processus de relocalisation, donc un déplacement interne. Et donc, qui pose des questions relatives aux territorialités, puisque même à l'intérieur des pays, il y a des problèmes sur l'accès au foncier ou sur les problématiques relatives à la relocalisation qui sont internes et qui sont difficiles à traiter. Imaginez maintenant quand il s'agit d'une relocalisation d'un pays à un autre, surtout dans les zones transfrontalières. Donc, c'est pourquoi cette dynamique interrégionale, cette dynamique multipartite, elle est extrêmement fondamentale si nous voulons apporter la meilleure assistance aux migrants qui subissent les conséquences désastreuses à la fois du changement climatique, mais aussi pour les pays du Sahel. La dégradation des terres, la salinisation des terres est une préoccupation importante au sein du gouvernement sénégalais, puisqu'on a un pays où il y a des zones de mangrove qui parfois aussi se situent dans des zones transfrontalières, notamment le long de la frontière entre le Sénégal et la Gambie, mais également le long de la frontière entre le Sénégal et la Guinée-Bissau, qui sont des préoccupations qui posent justement cette problématique de comment mieux accompagner ces populations, mais surtout comment développer une approche qui à la fois intègre non seulement les organisations de la société civile, les organisations nationales, les organisations, les associations de migrants au niveau national. C'est pourquoi l'une des actions du secrétariat d'État a été de faire une fédération des organisations de migrants de retour au niveau des 14 régions du Sénégal et de travailler avec les partenaires pour voir comment les intégrer dans ces projets qui visent à l'adaptation au changement climatique, qu'elles soient liées au changement climatique, qu'elle soit liée à la dégradation des terres, mais aussi à la salinisation des terres. Donc, ça, c'est extrêmement important. Et aujourd'hui, dans un cadre d'un projet global qui s'appelle le projet Gouvernance, Migration et Développement, dont la cible prioritaire, ce sont les migrants de retour installés au Sénégal. Nous sommes en train d'installer ce que nous appelons des BAOS, avec l'appui de la coopération espagnole et de l'Union européenne, qui sont des bureaux d'accueil, d'orientation et de suivi des migrants de retour pour leur permettre d'identifier leurs besoins, mais aussi de les orienter pour le financement de micro-projets dont beaucoup sont liés à l'agriculture et la gestion durable des terres. Et juste pour finir, puisque je n'ai que 7 minutes de communication, finir sur les défis. Aujourd'hui, le gouvernement du Sénégal a réussi à associer la société civile dans la gestion des questions relatives à la migration. Or, un de nos défis majeurs, et là, on a des progrès à faire. C'est justement comment mieux arriver à impliquer le secteur privé, qu'il soit le secteur privé national ou le secteur privé international, dans la prise en charge des questions relatives au nexus migration, environnement, changement climatique. Pour ne pas dépasser le temps de parole, je m'en arrête là pour le moment et je reste à votre entière disposition pour poursuivre les échanges autour de ces questions. Et encore une fois de plus, merci beaucoup de votre très aimable attention.
Merci, Monsieur Diaw. C'est nous qui vous remercions pour avoir réussi dans un temps si court à passer autant de messages importants, dont reconnaître la voix d'un pays, un des pays les plus vulnérables d'ailleurs au changement climatique, qu'est le Sénégal, et en particulier attirer l'attention sur la question très particulière de la montée des eaux, de l'érosion côtière, de la salinisation des terres, donc des choses extrêmement précises qui tout ont impact sur la mobilité humaine, ainsi que de nous avoir aussi attiré l'attention sur des bonnes pratiques dans ces fédérations avec les migrants, avec les organisations de migrants et sur la question du secteur privé. Donc ça, c'est vraiment parfait pour le panel d'aujourd'hui puisque nous allons parler avec un représentant du secteur privé un peu plus tard. Donc un grand merci. I will move now back to English to pass on the floor to our next speaker. So I'm also extremely proud that we have Dr. Balgis Osman-Elasha with us. I think that I want to just to highlight from Dr. Osman-Elasha's background that she is a lead author. She was a lead author of the IPCC report, and in particular, one of the key most recent IPCC reports on climate change and land, and that you were also back in 2007, named as a co-recipient of the Nobel Peace Prize as a contributor to the IPCC. So this is an amazing, I think, experience, and that you represented, I think, IPCC in Oslo, which makes a nice transition also with our next speaker who is from Norway. I know that you are a forester by training, and that today you represent in this dialogue as Chief of Climate Change and Green Growth Specialist and Regional Coordinator for North Africa Development and Business Delivery Center, the African Development Bank. So please go ahead, and many thanks again.
Many thanks for you for the introduction, and thanks to the IOM for the invitation to this very important dialogue. And the chance also to shed some light on what the bank is doing in relation to development and green growth. I will try to give, to shed light, as I mentioned, on these activities that have direct and indirect impact on migration in Africa and sustainable development in general. As you know, the African Development Bank, similar to other MDBs, it has its objective of achieving sustainable development and poverty reduction. And as such, it addresses some of the main causes of migration also. Out of Africa. And if we look at development simply as delivering services, well-being, contributing to well-being and improving the life quality, we can appreciate the role of the bank and its efforts to address these issues and also try to reduce the inequality in Africa, because these activities are trying to be across the different African countries and across the different societies. So this the issue of inequality, as we know, is one of the most important factors that contributes to poverty in Africa. And Africa is also known as one of the world's most unequal regions. Income inequality is very evident in unequal access to resources and opportunities between rural and urban, between men and women. And the bank is considering this issue seriously. That is why the long-term strategy of the bank 2013-2022 focuses on two main objectives, inclusive growth and the transition to green growth. So it's one of the areas that I think it warrants real attention. In terms of migration within Africa, it has always been an issue, internal migration and external also out migration. And the problem with migration in Africa, especially the internal one, it's usually out of the production sites to urban centers and without real skills, without opportunities for getting involved in manufacturing or industries. And instead, the migrants are always being absorbed by the service sectors and the informal activities, which are by no means contributing to production. So this will aggravate the economic problems and poverty problems in the countries and the continents in general. So to overcome this problem, Africa has to become more industrialized and to improve its production capabilities as well as productivity across the natural, human, physical, and other capitals. And in contribution to address this gap and to achieve profound transformation of Africa's economy and to unlock the potential of its citizens, the bank identified five key priority areas, what we call high five, the high five. That is feeding Africa through improved agriculture and agro-industries, powering and lighting Africa, industrialized Africa, integrate Africa, that is promotion of regional integration, and improve the quality of the life of Africans, especially poor women and young people. And to achieve lasting change for Africa, we need to focus on the youth, of course. As you know, Africa is continue to be like the continent with the most number of youth globally. The youth in Africa represent a large, more than 60%, and also globally, the number will be up to maybe one third by 2050 of the global youth in Africa. The problem is that African youth are also escaping poverty through migration. And poverty because of many factors. Some of them are related to climate change, others related to unemployment opportunities. So out of 13 million youth that enter the labor market in Africa each year, only 3 million gets job. That means 66% are not employed, and that they are not contributing to economic activities. And they were left with no option but to migrate. That is why migration trend in to Europe is still like embarrassing for Europe and for Africa. The bank identifies that the lack of employment opportunities for African youth is one of the most critical policy challenges of our time. And so the bank developed the Jobs for Youth in Africa strategy. The strategy selected three flagship programs as a priority areas. It's agriculture, industrialization, and ICT. And based on this, it launched an initiative, Jobs for Youth in Africa. This initiative targets to equip more than 50 million youth with employable skills and create 25 million jobs in agriculture, ICTs, and other related industries. The bank will work through this initiative to help mobilize $3 billion US dollars to support the young entrepreneurs in Africa, focusing on business incubation. And it will facilitate the establishment of a skills enhancement zone. This is an enhancement zone that will foster better linkages between skills and industrial development. Some examples of these programs are in agriculture, for example, is empowering novel agri-business-led employment, abbreviated as enable youth. It aims to help African men and women to incubate and scale up their agribusiness. As of now, the program is implemented in 11 countries across Africa, and there are room for more. It's a total investment of around almost 900 million US dollars. Also, the program is supporting the IFT Center of Excellence in Kigali. This is a joint initiative between Kigali Institute of Science and Technology and Canadian University. So the bank provided like 40 million US dollars to support this and to have like a second generation of computer experts in Africa. The bank also supported the establishment of digital technology parks in Senegal and Kenya. Coming to the issue of climate change and green growth. And we know that climate change is a threat multiplier for Africa. It is Africa considered as one of the most vulnerable continents. So the banks put as a main objective to ensure climate resilience and low carbon development in Africa, and to facilitate the implementation of this objective, the bank developed tools and methods and strategies that will safeguard its investments and also climate-proof the project portfolio. In this regard, the bank implemented concrete actions through the promotion of land use management, smart agriculture, water resource management, resilient infrastructure, and urban systems. Also, the bank financed the proportion of climate finance in the bank portfolio kept increasing from 9% of the total portfolio in 2016 to 36% by 2019. And now the aim is to have 40% of the portfolio labeled as climate finance by the end of this year, 2021. In addition, the bank committed to provide 25 billion in climate finance by 2025. The bank is helping the regional member countries access climate finance to implement their nationally determined contributions and climate change, other climate change strategies. So the bank gets accredited to the regional implementing entity for most of the global funds, including the Green Climate Fund, the Climate Investment Fund, the GIF. Moreover, the bank established critical internal finance support mechanism to address issues related to climate information, that is the Clean Dev Special Fund, to adaptation in Africa, Africa Climate Change Fund, ACCF, Africa Water Facility, Africa Climate Smart Agriculture Program, the Desert to Power Program, and others. So these are internal funds within the bank. Also, the bank continues to develop new climate funds targeting different sectors like forestry, agriculture, the private sectors, and our partners are very supportive in this regard. Like now we have the Canada FDB Climate Finance Facility and the Africa Circular Economy Multi-Donor Trust Fund supported by Finland and Nordic Development Fund. And the bank in-house now is developing an initiative that is the NDC Hub, which is established to support the regional member countries implement their NDCs. It is like a platform where partner institutions coordinate their climate change support interventions to deliver actions and in a very coordinated and efficient way. For women, there is a dedicated fund for African women that is affirmative finance action for women in Africa, abbreviated as AFAWA. This is an initiative to mobilize $5 billion in new financing to support women business in Africa. As of today, the bank is this is the last sentence. Working with 24 financial institutions in 15 countries and within this AFAWA program, and it's expected to expand rapidly by 2022. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you so much. I don't know, there was an intervention, but it was at the end of the time. So that was helpful. Thank you so much for bringing this very complete intervention to this panel. I would just highlight as a key point, I think, how you started on the question of inequality, and which is key question on the multi-causality of migration and how difficult it is also for us to just isolate the environmental and climate dimension from everything else that's development, conflict, education, demography, the wide range of questions we are facing when we discuss this topic. And also thank you for highlighting the gender dimensions. And thank you so much for giving all this wide range of different initiatives that are such a variety of initiatives, and of bringing also to our attention the key question of the climate funds and of the access to climate funds and the difficulty we have still to have projects with a migration dimension being funded by the climate funds. So that's absolutely key as well. Yeah. Thank you so much. I will pass now to our next speaker. We have three more speakers on this panel. So now it's really my pleasure to have Miss Enja Saethren. I hope it's well pronounced in Norwegian. It's very difficult. who represents for us today the vision of the private sector from our partner Scatec. You have also an amazing background, Enja, I must say. As a senior business development analyst in Scatec now, you work really towards increasing the access to renewable energy in developing countries. And we have also including collaboration with IOM on the solarization of the Malakal humanitarian hub. But you are in this private sector focusing on operating renewable power plants globally, worldwide, but but with a true focus on developing countries. And you have yourself also a whole background on refugee question, humanitarian. You work with the foreign affairs, you work with the World Food Program, you have amazing experience. So I stop introducing you and I let you speak. You have also 7 minutes. Thank you so much, Enja, for being with us.
Thanks so much, Dina, for that kind introduction. And first of all, it's very inspiring to hear about the green ambitions of both North Macedonia, Senegal, and the AFDB. Let me just start by putting Scatec on the map for you. So Scatec is a global renewable energy business that develops, builds, operates, and owns renewable energy projects across technologies in developing countries, as you rightly put, Dina. And what we do is becoming increasingly important. Around 800 million people do not have access to electricity globally, of which 615 million people live in Africa. And for displaced people, the numbers are especially striking. And limited access to energy is also a huge impediment also for other development indicators, such as protection, education, and jobs. And with displaced populations already being vulnerable on all of these indicators, lack of access to energy serves to reinforce pre-existing vulnerabilities and hinder development and reintegration. Energy needs in non-OECD countries are expected to increase by more than 80% by 2050. So if we are to reach the goals of the Paris Agreement, it will thus be immensely important what choices we make today in order to reach tomorrow's energy needs. And renewable energy needs to be at the cornerstone of that transition. But despite sort of the crucial role of energy in humanitarian action and commitments to carbon neutrality, the green transition in the humanitarian sector has been a slow coming process. I mean, the humanitarian agencies spend more than $1 billion on polluting fuel every year. And with a protracted crisis across the globe, fueling humanitarian aid can often consume a quite substantial part of the humanitarian budget. And apart from the obvious negative climate and cost effects, the diesel generators have not even been able to provide a secure and stable access to energy, you know, often hampered by power supply risks or fuel disruption. So in order to meet the goals of the Paris Agreement and reaching both net zero, increased electrification globally, and the SDGs, we have to embark on a massive scale-up of renewable energy. And the humanitarian sector must be part of that transition. And we are ready. I mean, the technology is mature and cost-saving, and we have also designed a model that specifically targets the needs and the procurement needs of humanitarian actors and tries to address the bottlenecks that until today has hindered private sector collaboration for providing green energy to displaced populations. And our solution is RELEASE. And I'll tell you why replacing fuel with solar and battery will both reduce emissions, save cost, and ensure a reliable power supply. So RELEASE is a pre-assembled, containerized, movable, and modular solar and energy storage system for rent, which then connects to the existing diesel generators to replace diesel and the electricity mix. And the key added value here is flexibility and simplicity. So being conscious of the budget structures in, for instance, the UN system, contract durations are flexible, down to 1 year, with then the option of either prolonging the contract or buying the assets at the end of the contract. And should the humanitarian activities in the area come to an end, well, then the contract can also be terminated. So short-term contracts, limited upfront payments, serves to reduce the buyer's financial commitment, both on the guarantee side and on the balance sheet. And it's immediate cost saving, you know, both compared to conventional solar in the same time perspective, but not least compared to diesel. So really making it easier for humanitarian agencies to embark on the green shift. And using batteries also addresses the power supply risks experienced with diesel generators, making the system stable and operable and enabling delivery of solar power 24/7. The system can be scaled up or down at any time, depending on the need. It's quick to deploy. The plan can be up and running like 6 months after a contract is signed, and it can be redeployed. And that fact, that this mobility factor also limits the environmental impact in preventing any permanent occupation of land, which is also a key factor. So I often say that release makes dollars simple. Because you have a simplified structure with one contract only, it's really like a plug-and-play solution where the equipment comes pre-assembled in containers. Scatec installs the equipment at the site and monitors the performance 24/7. And then we also train the humanitarian staff in local offices for maintenance, which also support knowledge transfer and capacity building. So we have several release projects in our portfolio, around 300 megawatts. And what is remarkable here is that many private sector companies, for example, mining companies, have shown a great appetite for the release concept, you know, driven by increased pressure to reduce their carbon footprint. But ironically, we haven't really seen the same sense of urgency in the humanitarian system. But last year, as Dina mentioned, we commissioned our first release project with a humanitarian actor, a combined solar and battery storage plant in South Sudan with IOM, which has the humanitarian hub in Molokol. And that plant has a PV capacity of 0.7 megawatt solar combined with 1.4 megawatt hour battery energy storage system that is now connected to IOM's existing diesel generators. And what's amazing about this project is that it reduces annual CO2 emissions by 80 to 90% by covering 90% of the energy needs with solar power. And it's cheaper, giving reduced energy costs of around 20%. And it provides a more reliable and robust energy supply than diesel. So it's like a no-brainer. And the good thing is also that the release model can also be a driver for local development, you know, with the potential to expand and deliver energy to health centers, to schools, and to other community services, knowing that, namely, unstable and costly access to electricity is a huge impediment for effective service delivery in rural areas, particularly. So the humanitarian agency would then act as the anchor client on the ground, and then with the possibility to connect to the local grid in a second phase. So that has a clear local development effect in both strengthening government-led service delivery and also with the handover of permanent energy infrastructure to the municipality after 10 to 15 years. So to wrap this up, the negative secondary effects of the COVID-19 pandemic have made displaced populations even more vulnerable, reinforcing the pertinence of the nexus between migration and climate change. But crisis also provides a momentum to make a change, to build back better and greener. And it's time for the humanitarian agencies to start monitor energy use, to set emission reduction targets and cooperate with renewable energy suppliers. And I think also donors setting clear requirements on to reduce fuel costs and emissions, and DFI is playing an important role in providing financing and guarantee structures. All of that can also help sort of spark that change. But I think the key message from you today is that we have a ready-made solution that really responds to the responsibility that we all bear now as renewable energy has become the most cost-effective alternative in giving populations in remote locations access to green energy. And we're very eager to discuss with you today and also onwards how we together can contribute to spur that green shift in displacement settings. Thank you. I think that was all.
Thank you so much, dear Enya, Saethren, for your presentation today. I think you brought to our attention the key question of access to energy of displaced population in camps or not in camp setting, and also the key question of our own impact of our own operation on the environment. And in particular, I think the very strong awareness that has happened over the past 2 years on the humanitarian side to better factor in green solutions and clean energy in the humanitarian response. So this is absolutely key. And also thank you for highlighting the importance of innovative partnerships with the private sector and the UN and all the organizations, and that solutions are already there. And that's very important. Thank you so much. I will pass now to our next speaker. We have two more speakers in my list. So I would like to introduce now Mr. Irfan Ullah Afridi, who has the amazing task to represent somehow the youth. You are at the United Nations Major Group for Children and Youth, a regional focal point for South and Central Asia. And I know you are also a humanitarian and DRR practitioner, researcher with the United Nations University with the Institute for Environment and Human Security. So the floor is to you.
Thank you so much, Dina, for the introduction and for having me. So before going to my presentation, I would like to kind of share some recent figures. If we see the past year, 2020, so the disaster which are caused by climate change caused more internal displacement than war in 2020. So especially if we talk about the natural hazard, so intense storm and flooding triggered 3 times more displacement than violent conflict did last year, and which led to 55 million internally displaced people by the end of last year, according to the figure published by IDMC. And according to the Refugees Organization, 30 million new displacement last year were due to floods, storm, and wildfire. So which is somehow clearly showing, highlighting the impact of climate change. So whenever disaster occur, young people or children are found to be present or a third of the victim of disasters. And youth are not just passive victim, but youth can react more flexibly and resiliently to dramatic changes as compared to adults. And despite that, young people can play an important role in protecting and improving the environment. So they can change their lifestyle, which can have positive impact in the environment. So they can also make their homes, schools, and youth organization more environment friendly by adopting environment friendly practices like recycling of different material, as well as preserving resources such as water and electricity. So engaging youth in environmental protection not only create tiring impact on changing youth behavior and attitudes, but possibly influence their parents, relatives, and family. So we have already seen around the globe that youth are already in the forefront of fight against climate change and COVID-19. And the youth are resource in climate change adaptation and sustainable development, but they can be a burden for the country, for the nation, if they are left unprepared and excluded from the different activities, especially if you talk about climate change adaptation and disaster risk reduction or sustainable development activities. And research have shown that youth participation in climate change adaptation and sustainable development can help them learn topics that positively impact their lives while acquiring the practical experiences that support them to become a better leader in the future. So, if we talk about the youth expertise in the youth innovative ideas, so they have quite a lot of experience and they have already shown. So the youth can offer innovative solution to climate change, adaptation and sustainable development in their action in community can help reduce the impact of climate change and improve resilience. But unfortunately, however, in many countries, youth contribution and youth engagement and community and climate change adaptation and sustainable development activities are below the desired standard. So if we talk about the nature-based livelihood and the youth participation or in the migrant participation, so there's a range of nature-based livelihood that exist and can help address the crisis of nature and climate on one hand, while also creating us prosperity on the other hand. So those livelihoods to maybe restoring forest, building green infrastructure, protecting mangroves, practicing agroecology and planting urban forest. Also the rain gardens, upstream and urban wetlands, spawn, green rooftop, green sidewalk and concept like spawns city, which the youth can be an integral part of it. So the practical and implementable nature-based solution can protect and enhance nature while also will create sustain and enhance decent employment and contribute to the achievement of sustainable development goal. But the most important thing is while planning and decision-making process, the youth should be in the heart of all those mentioned activities. So if we talk about the youth challenges, so there's some challenges for youth participation and for youth leadership, which are institutional. And they include lack of proper platform where youth can come, can exchange their ideas, and can somehow give the practical shape to the innovative idea which they really want to implement. And there is also capacity building, less of capacity building issues, and especially if you talk about the awareness and education on climate change adaptation. So there's also a lot need to be work to build the capacity of youth. And the most important, youth recognition is a key contributor. And other challenges also include tokenism and sufficient transparency in many countries, and bureaucracy in many countries are preventing the youth to come and to play the role which they want to play. So institutionalizing meaningful youth engagement, increasing coordination between the different organizations working with youth and also on climate change adaptation and disaster risk reduction, most important investment on youth, especially on their education and capacity building, and access to the finance could be the possible solution to enhance youth participation and sustainable youth participation in climate change adaptation and sustainable development. So to wrap up, today displacement crisis arises from many interconnected factors, including climate and environment change, conflict and political instability. So the world has been made more fragile by the COVID-19 pandemic, and sustained political will and investment and locally owned solution will be more important than ever. So if we talk about to build far better and greener, so youth should be put at the heart of the greener COVID recovery. And as rightly said in the video in the beginning, do the right thing. So let's come together. So let's work together, and working in the silos will not work anymore. Thank you.
Thank you so much for your intervention. It shows the amazing richness of migration experience, in particular for youth and children, in the positive and the negative, and the inclusion, the exclusion issues, and how much youth is the driver for change, the driver for climate action. We see this at the COPs. I look forward to COP for the youth intervention most of the times. I think it's the strongest voice coming up. You mentioned also the challenges of bureaucracies, and youth are the future leaders. So it's also about how you see the way they can advance and be included and contribute to the sustainable development. So thank you so much for your intervention. This was great. And now I will pass to the last speaker. Je vais repasser au français parce que nous avons la chance maintenant d'avoir, nous avons eu un côté un peu de la médaille avec le Sénégal qui nous a parlé du côté ministériel. Et maintenant, nous avons l'autre côté de la médaille où nous avons vraiment un entrepreneur, une voix de migrants, migrants aussi de retour, d'anciens diaspora. Vous êtes représentant aussi du secteur privé. Donc, Monsieur Belal Altinesto, vous êtes vraiment la dernière voix sur notre panel d'aujourd'hui. Vous avez vraiment passé du temps aux États-Unis, puis vous êtes revenu au Sénégal, où vous vraiment vous poussez pour l'émergence de l'agroécologie. Vous êtes passionné de l'agriculture et de son importance, si j'ai bien compris. Et donc, vous avez fondé une ferme agroécologique qui s'appelle Sor Ranch, avec en association avec aussi une jeune femme sénégalaise qui a fait ses études au Maroc. Donc, c'est vraiment une histoire extrêmement passionnante. Je vous donne tout de suite la parole. C'est à vous. Merci beaucoup.
Merci beaucoup. Donc, je dirais bonjour à tout le monde. Je suis honoré d'être parmi vous. Je m'appelle Belal Altinesso. J'ai 53 ans. Je suis sénégalais, migrant de retour, et je suis un paysan vraiment passionné de l'agroécologie. Ce que je dirais, que la planète que nous partageons tous a longtemps enduré. Longtemps enduré par nos gaspillages, nos gourmandises insatiables et notre indifférence en son égard. Elle est en train de s'essouffler, causant beaucoup de dérèglements. La rareté des ressources comme l'eau s'accentue, des catastrophes naturelles augmentent, la compétition fait rage, le travail se fait rare et la pauvreté est croissante. Nous avons des mouvements de population, des populations surtout jeunes, des campagnes vers les villes où la promiscuité et le chômage et des conditions de vie difficiles les accueillent. La migration reste un échappatoire ou un alibi d'échappatoire pour un mirage qu'on croit être clément et une solution au problème. Nous savons ce qui s'ensuit, nous tous. Tout un chacun est concerné par ces problèmes et nous devons apporter des solutions durables pour restaurer les valeurs qui nous ont prévalu de sauvegarder la planète jusque-là. L'approche doit être globale. Cependant, l'action doit être locale. Ainsi, ayant vécu 17 ans aux États-Unis, je reviens participer en Afrique, je reviens au Sénégal, je reviens dans mon pays natal pour apporter des solutions locales à nos communautés touchées de plein fouet par la pauvreté et la migration clandestine. Je ne le fais pas seul. Je suis avec une jeune femme de 27 ans, Aminata Ali, qui a fait ses études supérieures au Maroc, avec laquelle on s'associe pour fonder Saethren, qui est une ferme agroécologique. Aminata Ali dirige brillamment la ferme. Dans Saethren, l'agriculture et l'élevage sont simplifiés et prennent en compte la dimension de la préservation, du recyclage, du respect de la nature et de la solidarité communautaire essentielle pour une autonomie durable. Nous sommes sur 14 hectares, avec 14 employés permanents et 25 saisonniers qui pratiquent l'horticulture, l'aviculture, l'embauche bovine, ovine, caprine, la pisciculture et la transformation, tout en s'appuyant sur des interactions pour un gain durable. Pas d'engrais chimiques, pas de pesticides. On plante surtout, on reboise, on préserve la planète pour les générations futures. Toute cette symbiose nous permet de créer des emplois décents. Nous rehaussons le niveau d'estime en soi de nos travailleurs même, mais aussi d'autres apprenants qui viennent nous voir. En effet, nous avons accueilli entre 500 et 600 jeunes depuis que la ferme a commencé, disons depuis 2015. Donc ces jeunes sont formés dans différents métiers agricoles, parmi lesquels ces jeunes, nous avons 150, à peu près 150 migrants de retour. Donc l'OIM, à travers Tree of the Future, a formé 25 jeunes à la ferme dans notre centre. Nous avons un centre d'accueil qui s'appelle le centre d'immersion agroécologique. Tout cela, c'est à louer. Mais force est de dire que ce n'est pas suffisant. Le partenariat doit être plus accentué, il doit être plus inclusif. Et avec, en plus des formations, il faut de l'incubation, il faut du suivi sur le terrain. L'action des migrants de retour devrait se faire en rapport avec leur communauté, en rapport avec la réalité du terroir du terrain. Le travail de sensibilisation et d'action en amont est primordial pour couronner nos succès, nos efforts. Les jeunes doivent voir et vivre la possibilité et les opportunités de développement local. Les opportunités de développement local, afin qu'ils renoncent à l'immigration clandestine. Donc, ONG, privés comme nous, l'État, les collectivités locales et les communautés doivent travailler en synergie, en symbiose pour un impact local durable. La formation seule ne suffit pas, comme je l'avais dit. Il faut un suivi. Dans le temps, des contrats de performance doivent s'établir entre les gens que nous accueillons et nous-mêmes. Rendons à la planète ce qu'on lui a volé. Respectons-la, écoutons-la, aimons-la sans intérêt particulier. Et seulement là, nous pourrons avoir des solutions qui sont durables et viables pour la sauvegarde des générations futures. Ces générations futures doivent avoir un amour et un respect pour leur terroir, Donc, l'exemple de Sovrant est un exemple parmi tant d'autres. Il y a d'autres Sovrant. Quand je dis il y a d'autres Sovrant, il y a des jeunes dans les tiroirs qui servent de miroir ou qui doivent servir de miroir, qui doivent servir de relais, qui doivent servir d'espoir pour les jeunes. Il est impératif de mettre à la lumière du jour ces exemples afin qu'un effet que j'appelle un effet de contamination positive voit le jour. Le travail décent, le bien-être, la santé et l'épanouissement sont plus forts et plus efficaces que les gardes-côtes, plus efficaces que les barrières, plus efficaces que les murs de frontières. Donc, nous devons travailler sur ce travail de développement local. La lutte entre le changement climatique peut être, contre le changement climatique, peut être une voie pour créer de l'emploi vert, gage de sédentarisation. Donc, il faudra reboiser, il faudra faire une agriculture plus raisonnée, il faudra faire de l'agroécologie. Et ça, ça demande de l'emploi. Donc, ça va permettre aux jeunes de rester dans leur localité. Le clivage entre le nord et le sud, doit disparaître. Et ce clivage doit être remplacé par un partenariat imbu de valeurs d'humanisme. Les communautés, toutes les communautés sont humaines et indivisibles. Elles partagent la planète. Donc, vive la planète, vive l'amitié des peuples, travaillons en symbiose pour qu'il y ait un développement durable local et pour que l'Afrique puisse trouver son chemin et que cette migration clandestine, même si elle ne peut pas être freinée, mais quand même qu'elle se réduise. Merci, je vous remercie.
Un grand, grand merci, Monsieur Belal Altinso. Vous avez fait le lien vraiment entre l'agriculture durable, l'emploi, l'entrepreneuriat et vraiment les risques de migration. Comment réduire les risques de migration forcée, irrégulière, qui mettent en danger les personnes? Comment permettre des alternatives pour les jeunes et aussi la dimension locale qui seront aussi discutées dans le prochain panel? Donc, on va continuer aussi là-dessus. Now we came to the end of our panelist presentation. We spoke of the past, we spoke of the present, and we spoke of the future. We spoke of values, and we spoke really of solutions, very concrete solutions. And I open now discussion also to the floor. I saw a number of questions for taking the floor. So I will start with the ones I received and go through them. So I have first a request from our Deputy Permanent Representative of Ecuador, Mr. Alejandro Dávalos. The floor is yours.
Muchas gracias, señora moderadora. Deseo agradecer a los panelistas por sus valiosas e interesantes exposiciones. Efectivamente, el cambio climático exacerba los efectos de otras amenazas que provocan el desplazamiento de las personas, agrava la pobreza e intensifica la presión sobre los recursos, incrementando la posibilidad de conflictos y violencia. Por lo tanto, se necesitan medidas urgentes para incluir a la migración en todas las acciones de mitigación y adaptación al cambio climático. Para el efecto, es necesario trabajar en dos frentes. Primero, fortalecer las políticas migratorias a nivel nacional y local. Y segundo, fortalecer la cooperación, especialmente el financiamiento climático. En cuanto al primer frente, se debe asegurar que todas las estrategias para la acción climática tengan en cuenta a las personas en movilidad humana. Para el efecto, el Pacto Mundial para una Migración Segura, Ordenada y Regular es un marco sólido para optimizar los beneficios de la migración, abordando al mismo tiempo los riesgos y desafíos, incluidos los relacionados con los factores del cambio climático y los desastres naturales. El pacto recoge la necesidad de priorizar las medidas de mitigación, adaptación y resiliencia ante el cambio climático en los países de origen, a fin de minimizar los factores adversos que obligan a las personas a migrar. Igualmente, reconoce que si la adaptación in situ no es posible, se considere opciones de reubicación planificada y vías para fomentar la migración regular. Sin embargo, se requiere realizar esfuerzos para mejorar el entendimiento sobre el vínculo entre el cambio climático y la migración, así como identificar acciones y herramientas específicas y eficaces para su difusión. En cuanto al segundo frente relativo a fortalecer la cooperación, especialmente el financiamiento climático, es fundamental incrementar la inversión para incluir a las personas en situación de movilidad en todas las respuestas frente al cambio climático. Las agencias de desarrollo y las instituciones financieras internacionales cumplen una función crítica en este propósito. Por ejemplo, su experticia y asistencia técnica son necesarias para la creación de capacidades de respuesta a los desafíos de los movimientos migratorios relacionados con el clima. Igualmente, se requieren inversiones para infraestructura y reconstrucción de asentamientos afectados por los desastres naturales. Finalmente, la cooperación es esencial para asegurar que los migrantes se involucren en la transición verde y de esta manera los estados puedan construir un desarrollo más sostenible y las personas en situación de movilidad humana contribuirán en este proceso. Muchas gracias.
Muchas gracias, señor Davalas. I have a next request from the floor from Ms. Eudis Almeida, Director of Foreign Consular Services from Venezuela.
They are just connecting. I'm bringing them on. One moment.
And it's Mr. Eudis Almeida, sorry.
We cannot hear.
Hola, buenos días. Buenos días, buenas noches. ¿Me escuchan?
Sí, escuchan. Escucho.
En ocasión de este importante espacio de diálogo internacional que aborda temas sobre la migración, el ambiente y el cambio climático, hago propicia la oportunidad para hacer extensivo un cordial saludo en nombre de nuestro presidente constitucional, Nicolás Maduro Moros, y nuestro canciller, Jorge Arreaza. Expresamos también nuestro más sincero agradecimiento a la Organización Internacional para las Migraciones por desarrollar espacios como este, así como a los panelistas por sus presentaciones que realizan grandes aportes al debate, que nos permite abordar temas de especial importancia en la actualidad, como la elaboración de enfoques multipartitos para aprovechar las oportunidades y apoyar la inclusión de los migrantes y los desplazados. El Estado venezolano reconoce la necesidad de incorporar cada día más sectores de la población venezolana a la campaña contra el cambio climático. Hemos dado pasos firmes en esa dirección, pero todos los esfuerzos son insuficientes mientras esta problemática no se haya interiorizado desde la perspectiva social, ni fuera de los ámbitos institucionales del gobierno, y los movimientos sociales, ambientalistas y ecologistas. Un mayor nivel de conocimiento y concienciación sobre la afectación del cambio climático y su relación directa con la movilidad humana contribuirá, con la toma de decisiones más efectivas en torno a políticas del clima y mejoras en captación de la información básica ambiental, social y económica. Las fortalezas del actual sistema educativo venezolano y de las misiones sociales impulsadas por el gobierno bolivariano están a la orden del día para abordar con mayor amplitud la problemática del cambio climático y sus consecuencias en el estado de bienestar de nuestra población, mostrándolo como un elemento que incide permanentemente en el desarrollo del país. La educación, en sus diferentes niveles y formas, debe incluir métodos y formas de comunicación que permitan visualizar el cambio climático como un proceso constante, cuyos efectos asociados a la migración y a los desplazamientos internos pueden provocar alteraciones significativas en nuestro país y nuestro desarrollo, así como en toda la región. Todo ello significando además importantes desajustes a los sistemas económicos actuales. Venezuela y sus instituciones defienden la implementación de una perspectiva que incorpore a los sectores más jóvenes de nuestra población para confrontar un verdadero ejército ecosocialista capaz de impulsar una revolución verde, defensora de la tierra y de la Pachamama, cuyo eje central sea educar, formar y divulgar sobre el cambio climático, sus avances y consecuencias, también en torno a la expresión física y concreta de sus impactos y medidas de mitigación y adaptación. Muchísimas gracias.
Gracias, señor Almeida. I have a third request from the floor. I'm very pleased to have Mr. John Bingham from the NGO Committee on Migration. Hi, John. You are in New York, I think, now. So yes. Please go ahead.
Thanks very much. I'm representing the NGO Committee on Migration. We're one of the top priorities of the this global coalition of national, regional, and international civil society actors on the ground. It is a responses for migrants and migration and climate change context. So thank you very much to IOM and the speakers. Thank you, Dina, for really a fine panel and moderation. Just maybe 3 minutes maximum, maybe 2.5. Concretely, as you said, Dina, so well at the beginning, give us energy, you said to the minister from North Macedonia. And I think that's what migrants do. And when you added that it's important to talk not just of migrants forced to move, but migrants who move with their talent and their energy and their passion and their skills and their hard work and their innovation. That's the experience of migrants who cross international borders because of climate change and environmental degradation. So, you know, they have an in the bones awareness of the problem and the in the bones commitment very often and energy to try and change things for the better. So quickly, two concrete examples. One in countries of origin, contributions to countries of origin, and I'll follow happily the speaker from Senegal, from Saethren a few minutes ago, and one, an analogy, contributions that migrants bring to countries where they live. So the contributions that are made by earnings that migrants send home as remittances for survival, for resilience, for adaptation, for reconstruction. You know, about a week ago, the World Bank announced the latest figures of close to three quarters of a trillion dollars, U.S. dollars, of earnings migrants send to their countries of origin, most of them to countries that are in developing situations, many of them in countries that have suffered climate change and environmental degradation, in Central America, in Haiti, in the Philippines, and so on. So that contribution that migrants in countries of destination send back to countries of origin. And of course, as Mr. Sow said and others, the diaspora and migrants who return with skills to help their countries adapt or be resilient, among other things. And second concrete example, the contribution that migrants make in the countries where they live, the countries to which they've moved. An analogy right out of today's headlines and today's hopes. The COVID vaccines, the two most popular and effective COVID vaccines worldwide, were created by companies in Germany and in the U.S. that were founded by migrants, Turkish migrants to Germany, German migrants to the U.S., French migrants running one of the companies in the U.S. So migrants bring, as UNHCR likes to say, much more than just the bags on their back and what they can carry. They bring what's needed, and they do so in context of climate-forced displacement. So to finish, you know, this international dialogue on migration, always so smart and timely from IOM, it's actually talking about two types of climate change. One, the rough, the bad, the unwanted climate change, where the environment is ruined and people have to leave. But the other type of climate change is one we actually need. And that's a climate change that recognizes the importance of migrants to the whole world, as the minister from North Macedonia said, not just to one country, not just to one region, but to the whole world and what they bring that makes a contribution. And that's the kind of climate change we need to fight the other one. Channels for people to move, channels for people to work, channels for people to contribute their energy and their passion and their skill and a lived experience. Thanks.
Thank you so much, John, for speaking of remittances and more broadly about the contribution of migrants. I think this is a key message from our side also for this IDM. And I have one more request and then a question as well. So I give now the floor to Uruguay, to Ms. Alejandra Costa.
Thank you, Dina. We
can hear you.
Perfect. Thank you very much, Dina. Quería simplemente intervenir en nombre de mi país, agradeciendo especialmente la oportunidad de participar en este segmento para debatir posiciones y experiencias que vinculan los fenómenos de la migración, el medio ambiente y el cambio climático. El cambio climático conlleva interacciones complejas e impactos diversos. Ante esto, entendemos que es fundamental focalizar y jerarquizar los riesgos actuales y futuros a los cuales las sociedades se enfrentan para lograr una toma de decisión adecuada. En el caso concreto de Uruguay, los fenómenos de riesgo más frecuentes y de mayor impacto son las inundaciones, producto de desborde de ríos, lagos y embalses, luego de lluvias torrenciales. Este fenómeno ha provocado anualmente la evacuación de poblaciones con la obligación, obviamente, de proporcionar un sustento adecuado en materia de alimentos, vivienda y salud, además de enfrentar las pérdidas económicas que se derivan de la destrucción de bienes y de la producción agrícola y ganadera. Por lo tanto, Uruguay, así como gran parte de los países que nos acompañan en este evento, ha trabajado y avanzado en la reducción de vulnerabilidades, la adaptación al cambio climático y la construcción de resiliencia. Fortaleciendo estas dimensiones, hemos logrado estrechar las causas que finalmente motivan los desplazamientos y disponer de los elementos para la recepción adecuada cuando se desencadena una crisis. No es necesario decir que quienes se encuentran más expuestos a los riesgos, por supuesto que son los grupos más vulnerables. En este sentido, el fortalecimiento de la normativa migratoria en Uruguay es una de las formas de enfrentar los riesgos, ya que reconoce la problemática y provee instancias previsibles para tratarlas. La piedra angular de la política nacional migratoria es la regularización de todos los migrantes, creando mecanismos claros y accesibles para que sean documentados rápidamente. Sortea esta etapa, los migrantes acceden a los mismos beneficios y derechos que los nacionales uruguayos, incluyendo la cobertura sanitaria y la educación. De la misma forma, el país ha registrado importantes avances en los últimos años en la gestión integral del riesgo y la adaptación al cambio climático, con estrategias de reducción de vulnerabilidad de forma tal de disminuir las consecuencias que incitan los desplazamientos de la población por las crisis climáticas. En 2021, el vínculo insoslayable entre migración, fenómenos medioambientales y cambio climático podemos verlo a diario. No es posible negar la necesidad de que la comunidad internacional trabaje en conjunto para abordar, en base a consensos y a evidencia empírica, los efectos adversos que esta realidad puede arrojar. Tenemos posibilidades infinitas para abordar este complejo fenómeno, anticiparnos a los hechos, construir capacidades para crear comunidades más resilientes y hacer un óptimo uso de las nuevas tecnologías. Para ello, reiteramos que la comunidad internacional debe trabajar en conjunto, desarrollando e implementando políticas que, basándose en la evidencia científica, cuenten con un enfoque de derechos humanos y perspectivas de sustentabilidad. Muchas gracias, Dina.
Muchas gracias. I would like to really highlight and thank Ecuador, Venezuela, and Uruguay for the last interventions that really bring your region also into the discussion very strongly and highlight how vulnerable the region is and how many original and innovative policy and practice options are put in place in your in each of your countries. I have one extra demand now from a completely different region of the world, from the Philippines, from Mr. Albert Magalang. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Madam Moderator, for giving me this opportunity to share the Philippine views on how to develop multi-stakeholder approaches, and which would include other, especially the private sector, and also to how to ensure that there will be support for the inclusion of migrants to build a sustainable future. Madam Chair, thank you once again, especially to the IOM organizers and to the panelists of today's session. And once again, for the thank you for the opportunity for giving the Philippines the this time to share our thinking on multi-stakeholder collaborations to ensure that migrants are provided opportunities to be productive and self-sufficient despite being severely affected by climate change, environmental catastrophes, and socioeconomic drivers like conflicts. So the coming together of various groups for purposes of producing a multi-sectoral outcome that addresses unintended impacts like migration, this generates optimism that despite external threats like climate change and environmental upheavals, humanity can still surmount unimaginable difficulties and be inclusive as well, and at the same time mainstreaming migrant groups who have been excluded and bringing them back into the fold. You ask us, however, how we can actually do this when migrants have just been uprooted and are in an unfamiliar territories which would appear threatening. Our response to that is, migrants who have been dislocated from their homes and livelihood bases by environmental events like climate-induced disasters normally find comfort in being integrated and mainstreamed into familiar surroundings. If they came from communities which were dependent on the physical environment for well-being, they most likely will find comfort in being involved in nature-based interventions which enable mm-hmm. them to gradually heal and become productive again. It only takes a little push and a modest amount of support to facilitate their reintegration into mainstream society. Whether in land or water undertakings involving migrants in nature-based undertakings, we think is the fastest way to heal from trauma. Lastly, Madam Chair, migrants have their own unique contribution to recovery and redevelopment in the aftermath of disasters. So they must not be treated as outcasts, but mainstreamed into society as soon as possible. In fact, they should constitute part of the recovery plan, seeing that they are almost everywhere, and most of them form part of the regular working force in almost all countries. And lastly, Madam Chair, this mainstream consideration and treatment of migrants is as true for any natural hazard event as for human-induced ones that create displacement like the COVID-19 pandemic. Overall, the biggest resource for recovery are people, of which migrants normally comprise a considerable portion. Thank you very much, Madam Chair.
Thank you so much for speaking for the Philippines. We are coming to the end of the panel. I have one very specific question that I think will send also particularly to Mr. So from a participant from Martin Clifford. It's a very specific soil and water conservation question, and I think a question whether this can be also replicated in other contexts. We don't have now time if we want to move on to the next panel. What I will do now is just to give back to the panelists 30 seconds for a key message to close the panel, each of you. And I will start then with Mr. So, and then we'll pass you on the question more specifically so you can continue the discussion bilaterally, because I think it would be a very important and quite detailed response. So back to you just for 30 seconds of a closing remark.
Merci beaucoup. Le débat, il est très intéressant. Les points de vue exprimés sont aussi intéressants les unes que les autres. Ce qu'il faut retenir, c'est que collectivement, nous avons des défis à relever et que aussi nous devons nous préparer pour aller vers cette COP, mais aussi faire tout le travail nécessaire pour engager toutes les parties prenantes et particulièrement les communautés de migrants qui ont aussi un rôle à jouer parce qu'ils ont une voix à faire entendre. Et c'est à nous de créer les conditions qui soient favorables à leur expression. J'ai été très séduit par le discours, d'ailleurs très poétique, de M. Belal Altinessou, et qui a souligné un certain nombre extrêmement important que nous n'avons pas l'habitude d'entendre. Et il est important de créer ces cadres-là qui nous permettent d'entendre des voix qui ne sont pas habituelles et qui permettent aussi de changer notre perception et notre vision des choses. Parce que nous avons beaucoup à apprendre des uns et des autres pour aussi l'intérêt collectif des migrants. Les migrants ont des préoccupations, ils savent ce qu'ils vivent, ils ont des attentes. Et si on sait les écouter, nous saurons collectivement aussi trouver des solutions pour répondre à ces attentes qui sont extrêmement légitimes. Favoriser les différents cadres régionaux, les différents cadres de concertation, mais aussi les différents cadres de dialogue qui permettent d'avoir une socialisation commune sur ces questions-là est extrêmement important parce que, d'une certaine façon, nous essayons de regarder tous vers la même direction. Mais si nous ne sommes pas ensemble, on ne pourra pas apprendre aussi à travailler collectivement dans une dynamique qui soit positive et pour l'intérêt des communautés de migrants. Je vous remercie, merci, en tout cas, une fois de plus, de l'opportunité qui nous a été donnée de pouvoir partager avec l'ensemble de ces acteurs sur ces préoccupations-là. Et nous vous renouvelons notre entière disponibilité à poursuivre l'échange sur ces questions d'une importance mondiale même, je dirais. Merci
un
beaucoup.
Un grand merci, nous n'hésiterons pas. Je passe, vous pouvez en être sûr. Un grand merci encore, Monsieur Diaw. Je passe 30 secondes défi aussi. So 30 seconds, please, challenge Miss Osman-Elasha. One key message.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. I think, on a positive tone about migrants, I think they maintain links with their countries, and they really care, and they like to share what they gained. So, and this is very evident. So they create this type of networks during crisis, and they mobilize resources. We have seen this during the recent Sudan revolution. We have seen it during some of the climate change related floods that was very destructive in many parts in Sudan. We saw them mobilize resources and sending back home. So, this kind of networks that can be formed seasonally or on ad hoc basis could be more utilized if a strategy to make use of the of this the migrant the capacities their financial support to have like kind of adaptation projects, something that is sustainable, not only on relief like on crisis, but something that will link them more to their homes and also having a sustainable impact. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Message well received. Ms. Enja Saethren, 30 seconds key message.
I'll speak very quickly. So first of all, I think the discussion today shows that there is a shared understanding for the need to scale up the shift in green displacement in displacement settings. And I think that we all have a role to play here. The private sector can bring in the technology and the competence. Humanitarian sector has the local knowledge and understanding of needs for operations and for the vulnerable populations they support. And what we share is, of course, a very strong commitment to the do no harm principle, which I think should imply that also humanitarian actors take steps to reduce their carbon footprint in their host countries. And then just the last comment, if we really want to scale this up and scale up the green transition, I think that also DFIs like the Africa Bank and IFC can also play an important catalyst role. And especially when there is a local development factor here, I think that should be very much aligned with the core mission of theirs. But the key is that from a climate perspective, we start to run out of time. I mean, we're nowhere close to reaching the goals of the Paris Agreement, and we really need to accelerate the shift. And the point is that a value proposition is not really proven before you can actually show that it actually works. So I think it's important now to feel that urgency and find flexible ways of implementing more green projects to build that legacy. And that is what we've done with IOM in South Sudan, and we demonstrate that this works.
Thank you, Enja. I love the last words. It shows it works. Thank you so much. 30 seconds, Mr. Irfan, Ullah, Afridi.
Yeah, so my main message, you can say the main theme would be to build for a better and greener at the time of transition from effective youth participation to effective youth leadership. So listen to us. Not just work for us, but work with us. Thank you.
Thank you so much. The voice of youth that goes far into the future. And last but not least, Mr. Belal Altineso, we go back to you. 30 seconds, 30 seconds.
Oui, dernier mot. le dernier mot, c'est remercier Loïc, mais je dis que ces panels pareils doivent être fréquents. C'est dire que, qu'étant vraiment pessimiste pour notre génération, il faudrait qu'on se mette à jour et qu'on travaille pour les générations futures, qu'on change nos comportements, qu'on soit plus sobre, qu'on écoute la planète, que notre manière de consommer, qu'on la revoie, qu'on revoie nos solidarités, qu'on revoie notre humanisme. Et dire aux migrants, le monde est à vous, comportez-vous d'une bonne manière et Inch'Allah, tout ira pour le mieux. Comme je l'ai dit encore, vive la planète. Nous tous, nous sommes les fils de la planète et nous trouverons le chemin sur cette planète Terre que nous aimons tant.
Oui, nous ne voulons pas devenir des migrants vers la planète Mars, je dois dire. Je suis bien d'accord avec vous. Donc, un grand, grand merci pour ce merveilleux panel. Many thanks to all the panelists. Many thanks to all the people who took the floor. If there are extra questions, we'll pass them on to you very